There's a pastor whose name is Bob. He's a really good guy. And he's been in his church 5 or 6 years, and he's noticed a trend. And the trend is that people tend to serve in their ministries, in their lay ministries, from about September to June. And if they're not enjoying what they're doing come June, then they resign in June, and they take the summer off, and then they don't sign up in September. Bob's been noticing that the numbers of people who serve in his church have been dwindling, and he wants to turn that around. So Bob gets all pumped up one summer, and he says, in August, I'm going to turn this trend around. So he starts pumping up. He works out. He runs laps. He eats health food. He is really serious. He's going to turn this around. So the first Sunday of August rolls around, and he's got a church full of people, and he preaches a series, and the first week in the series is entitled, Whatever Happened to Commitment? And he starts beating the commitment drum. And he beats it and beats it and beats it. And by the end of the service, he says, now, if you people want to manifest commitment, if you want to show that you really love Christ and you really love this church, then you need to fill one of the open serving positions that we have in this church. So the next week rolls around, week two in his series. And in this second week, he decides that he's going to preach from the text, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Christ. And again, he's pumped up. And he says, deny yourself basically means whatever you like to do, stop doing it. Take up your cross means there's chores to do around the church. Of course you don't like doing them, but you got to pick up something like a cross and carry it for the sake of Christ. The third week he comes back and he spends the entire sermon reading from the Fox's Book of Martyrs. I mean, it's people, Christians getting their heads cut off. It's being thrown to lions in the Colosseum, being sewn into animal skins and ripped apart by dogs. It's being burned at the stake for the faith. And he says at the end of the sermon, he says, I'm not asking you to be burned at the stake. I'm just asking you to teach fourth grade Sunday school. We still need a fourth grade Sunday school teacher and a few other positions filled. And if you really mean business like our ancestors in the faith did, then I'm asking you to get up and go back and sign that document back there. The next week, he decides to pull out all the stops. He gets partway through his sermon, and he takes a little fourth grade girl named Janie up on the platform with him. And he says, Janie, I just want to ask you a few questions here in front of the congregation. How's it going to feel for you to be all alone down in your classroom like no teacher for a whole year? And she, you know, Janie says, boy, it's going to feel pretty awful, Pastor Bob. He says, and isn't it true, Janie, that if kids your age don't get loving instruction from a fourth grade Sunday school teacher, you wind up like using drugs and becoming an alcoholic and bailing out of the faith and all that? Well, she's not too sure, but she says, I think that's probably true, Pastor Bob. And so then Bob turns to the congregation and says, I don't care if you don't like to teach. I don't even care if you don't like kids. But we need somebody to help Janie for this next year and her friends down there in the fourth grade Sunday school class. So there's this business guy who's been listening all month long. And he had told himself from week one, I'm not going to sign up for anything. I'm not going to serve in this church. I don't have the time. I mean, I'd like to in my heart, but I don't have the time. But, you know, he's been getting a case of the guilties as the weeks have been rolling on. And when he sees little Janie down there saying she's going to go on drugs and alcohol if he doesn't teach fourth grade, he finally goes, that's it, time. I'll do it. I don't know how to teach, and I don't particularly like kids, but I can't stand it anymore. So he runs up to Pastor Bob afterwards, and he says, I'll do it. I'll teach fourth grade. So Bob goes home from church that day, and he says, I won the August recruitment wars. I filled every position in this church that needed to be filled. Now, he's not really asking, did he fill them with the right people? Are they suited for the positions they signed up for? Are they going to feel fulfilled? Will they be effective? He's got warm bodies in slots that needed to be filled. And you can imagine what happens. This business guy finds out about 4 weeks into his teaching to fourth grade. He doesn't like kids, and he's not a good teacher. And Janie's sitting in the class wondering if it might not have been better to be alone for the whole year than to have this guy who obviously doesn't know how to teach and doesn't like kids. The business guy gets increasingly unfulfilled and frustrated as the year rolls around. And he's got his calendar out and he's marking it down week by week. 47 more weeks, 46 more weeks. When June rolls around, he resigns. And he makes a commitment to himself. He says, when I'm back in this, when I'm sitting in this seat in August and Bob starts his next August recruitment wars, I don't care what he preaches on. I don't care how many chapters from the Fox's Book of Martyrs he reads. I don't care if he burns my wife at the stake. I am not going to sign up for another tour of duty like this because it just made me feel empty and frustrated. I wasn't effective. The kids weren't responsive, and I'll never do it again. Now, I tell that story because a lot of pastors have great hearts, but they're still a lot like Bob. I mean, they care more because they feel the pressure of filling these empty positions, these lay positions that have to be filled. They just fall into the trap of caring more about filling the empty positions than they do understanding and teaching their people about spiritual gifts. And I grew up in a really good church with good pastors who taught the Bible. I never heard the term spiritual gift from the time I grew up to the time I left the church to go to college. And then in 1 Corinthians 12, it says, it starts right out, Paul says, whatever you do, don't keep your people ignorant or unaware of spiritual gifts. Spiritual gifts are not just another program to lay on a church. Spiritual gifts are the way a church ought to be organized. It's an entirely different way to do church. It's an entirely different way of seeing church and seeing how the church ought to function. Lots of times at pastors' conferences, I'm asked, how do you get so many lay people involved in so many serving positions around Willow Creek? I mean, there are thousands of people at Willow Creek who are enthusiastic volunteers who really carry out all the ministries here. And I tell pastors as straightforwardly as I can, I say, first of all, senior pastoral leadership has to teach, embrace, implement in their own spirit, in their own life, value of the concept of spiritual gifts. Senior pastors have to understand the biblical information on spiritual gifts. They have to have applied it to their own lives in a way where they can talk freely about their own spiritual gifts. I strongly suggest that senior pastors take their staffs through the study of spiritual gifts, if for no other reason than to make sure that the staff members are slotted in positions that are consistent with the spiritual gifts and passions that the staff members have. But then there's more than just pastors and staffs knowing about it and teaching about it, because some senior pastors do teach widely and regularly about spiritual gifts. That next step is critical. There has to be a place or a process or a ministry in the church where motivated lay people who are responding to the pastor's teaching on it can go and say, I'm signing up. I want to know what my spiritual gift is. I want to know where it can be used. I want to know what my secondary and third gift would be and where I can put it into activation in this church. That's why we so strongly suggest that a ministry in the church is set up as a kind of a clearinghouse, if you will, a training center, a consultation place, a clearinghouse for this, or a launching pad for lay people to go when they want to take action on the preaching that they've heard about spiritual gifts. And then there's some direction giving. Where might I apply this with the giftedness and the passions that I have? And then there's the follow-up piece later on saying, is it working out well? Do you feel effective? Do you feel fruitful? Are you fired up about using your spiritual gift in that way? So there's a senior pastoral piece, there's the staff piece, but then there's that ministry launching pad or departmental piece, the process that has to be in